Your living hope, your prayer. God is good.
All the time.
Come on, God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
You guys can be louder than that. God is good.
All the time.
There we go. And all the time.
God is good.
Woo. Man, you guys are amazing. You guys are amazing. I know I usually like, you know, take a minute to pray and stuff, but we got some exciting things happening today. I get to share something in a few minutes that is just incredible.
Amazing. So we should all be trying to do such things with our children and making sure they understand these principles and how valuable they are to our hearts and our souls and our relationship and walk with Christ. This morning we have some announcements for you as we are working this week into our Bible study beginning on Wednesday evenings from 6:30 to 7:30 down in the fellowship hall. And for those of you that cannot be here in person, it will be live streamed. That is why it is strictly 1 hour long.
They'll be able to interact, not just stream, but yeah.
Yep, you'll be able to interact, but it's, and if you need a link, we have to have your email today in order to get that link out for Wednesday night. So keep that, make sure Pastor has your email.
Yep.
So he can send that link out to you so you can connect. A lot of you can connect on your cell phones or computers at home. Are there any other announcements, Pastor?
Yeah. I got it.
Okay.
I got it from here. You can take that with you.
Oh, take it with
you. Yeah. Isn't she amazing?
No.
Yes. All right. as it still stands, she mentioned this last week, but if anybody can help us kind of clean up the front flower beds, it'd be great. Let us know. Also, for those of you guys who are watching online, our giving link is in the description there to our video, whether it's on Facebook or later on YouTube. You guys can give that way as well. There's a basket in the back of the sanctuary. I want to move on to the next thing because I'm pretty excited. Last week, the last couple of weeks, we've heard some pretty cool things that have been happening. Pretty cool things have been happening with people in the church. And I'm going to kind of put them on the spot. I didn't tell them I was going to do this. But if you guys remember, we've been praying for Mike. You guys know Mike LeBounty's, right? We've been praying for him, asking God to do some pretty incredible things in his life. He was diagnosed with cancer last year, pretty bad. And this cancer was all over. Did you hear the word was? His cancer was all over, and they were concerned, deeply concerned. They started doing treatments and stuff. They gave him some not-so-good outlook on what was going on and what were the results of that or what was going to happen. I don't know. Did she take that mic with her? She sure did. Oh, no, it's back there. Mike, do you feel comfortable talking for a minute? Yeah, okay. So you could just stand back there if you don't mind. You can talk into the mic there. But it's okay. There you go. All right. It was just the power button. Anyway. All right. So Mike has got a pretty incredible story. They started calling him Miracle Man over there. But go ahead, Mike, just real quick. Make sure you're talking to the mic, though, so we can hear you.
A little over a year ago, I was diagnosed with squamous cell cancer in stage 4. And they said I only had 8 months to live if I didn't try the new treatment. It was called Keytruda, and as of 3 weeks ago, they did a PET scan, and they're totally amazed in Hanover. They said there's no cancer in my body right now.
Been following the story with them, bumping into them place to place, and talking to him, and he's like, well, it just keeps shrinking. They were all these different spots, and it just keeps shrinking until it's gone. Right? That's amazing. That is truly amazing. God is good, right? Come on. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time?
God is good.
All right. Amen. Amen. Let's let that feed the algorithm a little bit for those of you guys who are social media privy. We're still in the series called Just Keep Going. And this morning's title is, It'll Be Worth It. It'll Be Worth It. Now, I've been saying God is good and all that stuff because we're going to talk about being God's goodness to others in just a few minutes, but we are living in a world of crisis, right? We're living in a world of crisis. There's economic uncertainty. There's struggles with social and racial injustice. There's political instability. There are physical and mental health issues and challenges that have, with a broken system that's not been able to treat those things, climate change, humanitarian issues, natural disasters. I mean, there are things happening everywhere, right? Everywhere. Now, we have moments of miracles that we're hearing about, good things that are happening. It's been incredible, but we're struggling. We're getting weary, honestly. I mean, we're seeing technological advances in so many fast and changing and just incredible ways that some people, I was listening to a news podcast the other day, and they were talking about this AI, this artificial intelligence. I don't know if you guys have heard anything about this, but there's this like advancement of you can have conversations with this artificial intelligence and it'll talk back to you and you can talk back to it, et cetera, et cetera. And the guy who was like very responsible for making it said himself he's gravely concerned about it, right? Gravely concerned about it. We're just messing with all kinds of things. And here's the truth, okay? Media makes us mad because that's what media wants. And as crisis creates content, and content makes money. You agree with that? Yeah. And so we find ourselves feeding on this stuff. We find ourselves aggravated and frustrated. We find ourselves consuming all of these different things. All of these different things. And the truth is that we all have a lot of quit in us. Now, there is something that has happened in us. Paul Eldridge said it this way. Cynics are only happy in making a world as barren to others as they have made it to themselves. And here's the truth. Many of us have traded hope for jaded cynicism and a whole lot of quit. We just want to give up, right? We're weary. It's challenging. It's difficult. There's a lot going on. There's a lot that wants to snuff out our hope and snuff out our courage and snuff out what we believe. A lot of people have traded their hope and traded believing and promising things in this like jaded cynicism, in these feelings of brokenness, in these feelings like cynicism is a worldview or attitude characterized by just plain skepticism or mistrust or a belief that a person is only about their own interests and their own motives instead of thinking that people are concerned. And jaded is something that, like, it's weariness or disillusionment. Now, we hear miracles like the one we just heard. We hear miracles like what Mike just shared. We hear little kids quoting the Lord's Prayer. But when we leave this place feeling a little bit good about ourselves and we turn on our phones and we begin to move on, you know, whatever is happening in your social media feed, and you begin to go and you're like, okay, this is what's going on. Oh, my goodness. Like, you see all these news articles and they're frustrating and they're overwhelming and you're like, oh, man, look at this and look at this and look at this. And then you come across like a funny picture with some text on it. You're like, oh, that's hilarious. And then you go on to the next one and it's just, it's overwhelming. Political perspectives, political attitudes, political thoughts, and every bit of hope that we had, something good happened or blessed happened, and we're just like, oh, well, there goes that. Now, Galatians 6, 9 and 10 says this, let us not get tired or weary of doing good, for we will reap at the proper time if we don't give up. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us work for the good of all, especially for those who belong to the household of faith. Let us not grow weary. Let us not get tired. Let us not get overwhelmed. Let us not arrive at a place where we just want to throw in the towel because it's just too much. It's just too much. Oh, come on. Like, we find ourselves so frustrated that when we get up in the morning, the last thing we want to do is think about something good that can happen. The first point I want to make to you this morning is wake up every day ready to do something good. Don't grow weary. Don't get tired. Don't get weary in doing good. We need to wake up every day with the idea, with the perspective. Here, listen to this. People are so well adjusted to being miserable that when someone is joyfully kind in the morning, they are accused of naivety and ignorance. Like, seriously. And like bumping in your step, you're like, woo, I feel good this morning. I got up early, got my workout in, I'm walking around, breakfast was great, and everything's good. And they're like, oh, what is wrong with you? How can you just like suddenly be happy and everything's great and wonderful? Have you seen that the world is practically burning around us? And even that sounded sarcastic and cynical, but that's where people are. That's what they're feeling. Now, I understand that when you decide that you are going to wake up and do something good, it requires a little bit of arguing with yourself. Because some of us in this room, let's face it, the alarm goes off and you begin to roll over and you're like, I didn't know that I could crack like that, right? Snap, crackle, pop is no longer about Rice Krispies, it's about you, right? You're like, I didn't know my knees could make that noise, woo, you know? And then you're like walking up the stairs and you hear cracking and you think it's the stairs, but actually it's your knees. Right, babe? And you're like, oh, what's going on? And you go up and then back down. You're like, oh, wait a minute, that's my body cracking, right? And so, like, we have to sometimes argue with ourselves. When we wake up and we're like, I'm going to do something good today. Now, like, some of us get afraid because how can I affect the world? How can I change anything? How can I do something about injustice? How can I do something about the socio-economical issues in our world? How can I change or leverage what I believe to help in this world in any way? And we just get so, like, overwhelmed. We're like, I can't do anything. Nothing I do is going to matter. You know what? Sometimes the good that you need to do is just within your own home. Like, some of us wake up nasty, and it just sets the tone for the entire day. You need to decide, like, look, I'm going to serve my family. I'm going to love my spouse. I'm going to love my children. I'm going to love my parents. I'm just going to be present, and I'm going to decide to do something good. I'm going to decide to be there for people, to encourage people, and I'm going to do something about it. John Wesley said this. He says, do all the good you can, by all the means you can, in all the ways you can, in all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as you ever can. Just let that settle in for a minute. You just got to be about it. Like, we call it random acts of kindness, and that's cute. Like, we're like, oh, just be, you know, have these, like, whenever opportunity provides itself, just have a random act of kindness. I want to challenge you to not be random about it, to be intentional, to open up your awareness. If we have, like, tunnel vision and we're only about ourselves and only about what we want and only about what's going on in our own life, we're going to miss it. We're going to miss it. Seriously. Like, this is not my wife and daughter were in Littleton. Nora's not had a good week. She's had some issues with her ear. She burst an ear, eardrum. It's been bad. But they're in Littleton getting some stuff done, and they pull up to the road, to the over by Walmart, getting ready to turn down to pick up a prescription, and there's this man just standing out there. All Nora had was some, like, peanut butter crackers. Let's give it to him. Like, that's what I mean. Like, you may not have a lot, but shoot, it's a little package of peanut butter crackers. You don't know what that would do for a person. You don't know how much that could change a person's idea. And her apple juice. Thank you, sweetie. And her apple juice, right? Because there's awareness there, right? Like, if it's just random acts of kindness, it's like, oh, let me, you know, just kind of go about my business. Hopefully I'll be interrupted by something. But if we get so concentrated on what we think we need to do or what we need to focus on, we won't even see if a need is staring us right in the face. And so, like, we've got to wake up with the intention to do good. We've got to wake up with the intention of, I'm going to do something about the needs that are present. I'm going to participate in helping. Like, we get so tired, too, because people are mean. You ever do something good for someone and only receive, like, hate back? You ever do something good for someone? They're like, oh, you trying to act, you know, you're so good, so wonderful. Look at you trying to be benevolent to me like I don't have anything. You're like, no, hold on, wait a minute. I'm just trying to be kind. This isn't about me being better than you. This is about me helping you and encouraging you. We got to check ourselves. We got to make sure that we don't allow what people have done to us to affect what we're going to do for them, because there is a lot of people out there that are absolutely frustrating. You share compassion and they take it wrong. But there are moments when things change. There are moments when life changes. There are moments when everything changes. I mean, if you go back to that scripture in Galatians chapter 6, it says, let us not get tired or grow weary in doing good, for we will reap at the proper time if we don't give up. The second point I want to make, this is it, second point I want to make is trust God for the season that will come. You sow, what you sow, you will reap. This isn't a karma thing, okay? This isn't like what comes around goes around, or if you're nice, then people will be nice. No, this is not it at all. This is what you decide to put into the ground, what you decide to sow, the decisions you make, the seed you decide to plant, the love you decide to give, the support you decide to give, those are the things that will reap. Those are the things that will bring something of value later on in your life. Those are the things that is going to change the world around you. And in this point, I want to say it'll be worth it. Now, I want to name a couple of things that happen. I can't talk in their entirety, but I just want to name a couple of things that'll happen when we begin to sow the right way, when we begin to do good, when we begin to not get tired in helping people. Number one, people change. I don't care what anybody says. Everybody's like, oh, you can't teach an old dog new tricks. Bull. Because I've met some pretty old, crotchety people who have found Christ and they've changed. I don't mean that to sound disrespectful, but there are some mean people out there. And you're like, ooh, they're just too far gone. I don't know, man. I don't know if anything can happen to them. I don't know if anything can change. I don't know if their lives can be any better. And you just keep being consistent. You keep being compassionate. You keep being helpful. You keep encouraging. And then something happens. You're like, whoa, wait a minute. This is the kind of stuff I'm talking about reaping. When we see this, it's not like this, oh, well, if I continue to do good, something good is going to happen to me. Yes, that will be the case, but things will happen. People change. Next, our greatest enemies become our greatest allies. I can speak and attest to this because it has happened in my own life. Like, seriously. I've been in workplaces and vocations where a person starting out, like the first couple of weeks wanting to quit because somebody was so mean to me. I mean, so mean. Really mean. By the time I finished working at that place, we were best friends. We were best friends, and it was the oddest thing in the world. I'm talking about someone specifically. It's the oddest thing in the world because there was about probably 30, maybe 20 or 30 years between us. Just like how could this even be possible? Like when you do good for people, when you help people, when you encourage people, when you do something of value, when you decide that you are not going to grow weary in doing good, your greatest enemies will become your greatest allies. And that seems ridiculous because there are a lot of enemies out there. People greater understand Jesus' pure love. I'm about this. Our love is conditional. Our love is imperfect. Our love is not that great. Our love is affected by culture. Our love is affected by the relationships we're in. But when we begin to do good every day, when you wake up with the intention of doing good, people are going to see Jesus. They're going to. You're going to arrive at a place where you're going to be talking to somebody and they're going to say, you know what, you've been so kind, so compassionate, so helpful. I'm willing to listen for a few minutes about what you have to say instead of us trying to push it on them or try to force them to change. Now, some people are like, be such a strong Christian that they don't even have to hear a word you say. Be so real about your faith. And I understand that, but there is a time when you need to start saying. You need to start speaking. You need to start sharing. When you gain that audience, when you gain that place of presence in their life, they'll begin to say, wow, Jesus is somebody I got to know, because if Jesus is the one that is causing you to love me like this, I got to know who he is, because that's a different kind of love. I know it's hard because we live in a jaded and cynical world, and the last thing we want to do sometimes is love people, because there's a lot of unlovable people out there. But when we begin to do that, things change. Next, the truth that God is love is perceived with greater clarity. God is love. That's what the Bible says. We love because he first loved us. If we don't love, that means we don't really know God. We love because he first loved us. And the truth that God is love will begin to show towards others. When you give money to different endeavors in ministry, that will do something that proves God's love, because it will step outside or stretch outside of just buildings and places. It will begin to affect people. Right? I mean, like, when we get involved, when we participate, when we say, oh, I don't have any money, but I've got a skill set, so I'm going to step in and help somebody in their time of need. I'm going to apply what I'm gifted at in an area where they need support of some kind. For some of us, it's just praying. Like, just like hitting it hard and asking God to help, asking God to do something about their need. Some of us, it's a word of encouragement. It's just, you know, like, the truth about God's love, that God is love, is perceived with great clarity. People will begin to see it more clearly. You step on the scene, you step into their situation, you step into their struggle. You see, authentic joy becomes an experienced reality. Now, this is good, because we're like, if you don't grow weary in doing good, if you keep helping, if you keep doing good, if you keep doing good, you keep doing good. It's talking about a reward that comes, but I've just been listing the rewards. I've just been listing the things that you reap. I don't know if you've ever experienced this before, but when there's a shift from trying to gain, and to acquire, like, this is going to make me happy, this is going to make me happy, this is going to give me what I need, and then you begin to turn and you begin to help people, you begin to encourage people, you get to leverage your resources to be a blessing to others, you will experience a joy that cannot be explained. It can't be defined. You're like, the reward you reap is the joy that you experience. A supernatural moment in your life where you have watched somebody who has been in a place of suffering and struggle, a person who has great need, and you watch as something so amazing happens in their life that it changes everything about what they see. And you're like, whoa, that was pretty cool. That's better than anything that I could have, anything that I could gain, anything that I could acquire or want to have. And here's what we're doing. This is in 1 John 4:9 in the Passion Translation. It says, our love for others is our grateful response to the love God first demonstrated to us. You got to be about it. His love for you, right? As wretched and broken and messed up as you are, his love for you should be something that causes a response to love others. What Jesus did for you, the sacrifice he made for you, the freedom he brought you, the hope that now lives in you, the truth that you can face whatever comes because he promised to be with you, to always be with you, that love for you should cause a worshipful and compassionate and mercy love for others. I'm grateful that God loves me. Now I'm going to love people. He loved me. Why can't I love others? It's tiring. I know. As a minister, I cannot tell you the amount of times that I've stood with somebody and I talked with somebody and I wanted to grab their shoulders and shake the hell right out of them, if you know what I mean. Just want to, like, wake up, let's go. They just don't get it. You fear they don't get it. And then that one moment happens, you're like, whoa, you did get it. You were getting it, but I didn't know you were getting it because I was too focused on what I wasn't seeing. Right? It's hard sometimes, and we get weary. We get cynical and jaded. We wake up in the morning, and we're like, okay, another day of life. Thanks, God. I got breath today. My body hurts, and I'm angry. I'm going to walk around, and okay, I'll try to do something nice or good for someone. And then somebody, like, cuts us in line or pulls out in front of us in on the road, and, like, the first thing out of our mouth is nothing good. You find out real quick your intent for good of others. You'll find out real quick what your intent for good of others is when they tick you off. You'll find out what it really means, what it really means to not grow weary in doing good. To not grow weary in doing good. There are things that are going to happen if we are relentless about our compassion. There's like a, for those of us who are on social media, there's like an algorithm, and our anger and our passionate emotions in the wrong way are just feeding it and feeding it and feeding it. And our social media experience and our media experience and our connection with the news or whatever it is just begins to create, and it just like elevates our anger. And it messes everything up. We're like, fine. Just, I don't want to do this anymore. I don't want to deal with this anymore. I'm just going to recluse. I'm not going to talk to people. I'm not going to open my heart up. I'm not going to be kind because it never goes well. See what happens? I was nice. Now I'm going to worry about me. I'm going to do me. I'm not going to worry about anybody else because I got hurt too much. You imagine if Jesus acted like that? I got hurt too much. Good luck, humanity. Good luck. No, he didn't do that. He didn't do that. He stepped out there and he loved you anyway, knowing that he was going to be nailed to a cross. And then he was up there on a cross and he's like, forgive them. Shoot. Really? Yeah, really. You know, when they were shouting up to him, like, if you're the Son of God, come off that cross. You better believe if I was up there, like, whoa, you know, like, let's go, you know. There's going to be problems, right? No. Nope, not doing that. I'm going to die. I'm going to lay my life down. And it started a revolution that still can't be silenced, still can't be snuffed out. And we look and we're like, oh, what is going on? And we hear news and we hear people talk and we're like, oh, the church, people aren't coming to church. Things aren't good and things are bad. Things are falling apart because that's what we want to see. That's what we're focused on, and we can't even see what's happening. Like our movement, the Pentecostal movement, our kind of church, our kind of experience, this evangelistic fire and hope is the most rapidly growing church in the world. And that's something. That is something. And the churches that are most rapidly are the churches that are facing the most affliction in other countries. We're going to see what we're looking to see. See, our love for others is our grateful response to the love God first demonstrated to us. I love because he loved me. My love for people is an act of worship to him. And so let me ask you three questions as we close. Just these three questions. What has made you weary? Let me count the ways, right? Let me count the ways. Some of us are just so tired, we just don't know if we can be nice. I'm sorry, I'm crabby. I got 3 hours of sleep last night, right? I'm sorry, I'm frustrated. You know, things are just not well. Okay. I'm going to pray that when you're in that state, somebody will send someone who will love you and help you. And if some of you have been interacting with people like that, and you're like, I don't want to talk to you. You're, you know, I'm not telling you to submit or be abused. I'm not telling you that to go into relationships that are bad and toxic. But what I am saying is that there are opportunities for you to love people that you need to. So what is making you weary right now? How can you begin to reflect the nature of God's goodness? In what way can you trust God with the season of reaping? And will you trust Jesus today? That act of trust is a work, man. It's a work. You're like, man, I've been loving this person, or I've been doing this work. I've been helping people. I've been doing all this for a long time, God. What's up? I've been at this for a decade. Some of us have been at it for a couple of decades, and we're just like wondering what's up. And God's like, oh, just wait. I know it's hard now, but, and I don't mean to be like, I don't mean it to sound like this, but just wait till you get to glory. This is just it's going to be over before you realize, and you may be dealing with some stuff right now, and it may be hard, but just wait till you get to heaven, because it's going to be good. It's going to be exciting. It's going to be thrilling, and you're going to look at the Lord right in the face. You're going to look at Jesus, and you're going to be like, oh, it was all worth it, because right now what I'm facing does not even begin to compare. The suffering that I went through does not even begin to compare to what I have now. And some of us were so tired, but God wants us to know that you can trust him for the windfall, man. It's going to be good. I still believe. I fight for optimism, because like everybody else, I have an inclination for pessimism, but I fight for optimism. And I'm like, something good is going to happen of this. Something great is going to take place. I'm just going to keep loving people. I'm going to keep helping people. I'm going to keep praying for people. They're going to reject me, but so what? I'm going to care, because that's what God has called me to do. And I'm going to be excited, because people are going to change. Things are going to change. Your situation and their situation will change. How do I know that? Because I've experienced it. I've seen it. I've witnessed it. I've felt it. I have been so not good to people before, and they've been good to me, and it has just wrecked me and humbled me and changed me. And I want us to be brave and bold enough. I know it's tiring. I know it's exhausting. We are living in an entirely different age. I can tell you over and over again that I never thought that I would see the things that I'm seeing right now. Never thought I would witness what I'm witnessing. I never thought I would see what I'm seeing. Never. And I would lie to you if I told you that there weren't times in my own life where I just wanted to go into hiding and say, psh, I am, nope, not going to help anymore. This is a waste of my time. Don't grow weary. Don't get tired. It'll be worth it. It'll be worth it. You get on the other side of that exhaustion, something big happens. You're like, it was worth it. You keep pushing, you keep moving, you keep investing your energy in love and compassion and mercy. You keep helping people. You get to the other side and you're like, it was worth it. You see that person change that you never thought was going to change. It was worth it. You're going to see a culture, a church, a culture, a family. You're going to see them change, and then it'll be like, it was worth it. It was worth it. You're going to trust God for the season that's coming, and you're going to believe that miracles will take place and things that you will marvel at will take place, and you're going to say to yourself, it was worth it. So this is me telling you right now, it's worth it. Keep fighting. Keep vigor. Fight with the same passion and anger that you want to fight against people that are not like you, to fight for people that are not like you. It's time. Because it'll be worth it. It'll be worth it. It'll be worth it. Just keep going. Just keep going. Just keep going. Just keep going. If it's loving people in your own house, love people in your own house. Loving them online, love them online. Loving them in your school, man. For those of you guys who are in school right now, loving people in your school, even though they're awful, do that. Loving people at your work, do that. Loving people on your own street or your own town, your own community, do that. Get to it. Just keep going because it'll be worth it. Jesus, I pray today that we would be encouraged and strengthened. I pray today, Lord, that we would look at your word, that we would realize that if we don't grow weary in doing good, that if we don't get tired in it, that we just keep going and keep moving and keep motivating ourselves, even though it's challenging and hard, that we will reap something that we never thought possible, that the reaping of our work and our effort and our energy would not only create something lasting now, but something that is eternal. Lord, that people will change, that lives will change, that, yes, churches will change, communities will change, families will change. Jesus, help us in our weakness. Give us vigor. Give us passion. Help the anger that we have to drive us towards good. Help us to allow that anger and that frustration and that fear and that madness that exists within us to just drive us to help, not to harm. Jesus, I pray today would be our day. That this would be our moment, that we would experience something because we felt a new invigoration of the desire, the craving to do something good. Help us to start today, and when we wake up in the morning, when we're feeling that frustration and aggravation of another day, help us to look at your goodness, God. And your love for us through your son, Jesus. And choose good. It's in your name we pray, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Love you guys. Go do something good today.